Hello everyone, welcome back. The topic is avulsion. Avulsion is a type of a traumatic injury, and this video, so the notes that I'm going to give through this video, so you can write it both in endodontics and in periodontics. So if you get a question on avulsion, then this particular notes you can write in both of your exams. So before starting with the avulsion, I'm going to give a brief about this classification of the traumatic injury, because now if you get a LAQ on avulsion, then it is always associated with this classification that you are asked to write any classification of the traumatic injury, and the one which is commonly asked is the Ellis and Davis classification, and this was given in 1960. So this classification, it has this 9 classes. So class 1, it is a simple fracture of the crown which is involving only enamel. So it is a fracture of a crown and it involves only enamel. So class 2 is, it is an extensive fracture of the crown which is involving considerable dentine but not the dental pulp. So class 2 is when the fracture, it involves enamel and dentine. Class 3 is, again, it is an extensive fracture of the crown. Now it involves all the three, that is the enamel, dentine and pulp. So this three classes, it becomes very easy to learn. So the class 1 was, it involves only enamel. Class 2, enamel and dentine. Class 3 is enamel, dentine and pulp. Now this class 4 is, now when the fracture of the tooth, it leads to the tooth which becomes non-vital. So this is class 4. Now class 5 is the avulsion. The avulsion is the one topic, is the topic that I'm going to cover now in this video. So avulsion is nothing but the total displacement of the tooth. So the whole of the tooth, it comes out of the socket. So that is nothing but avulsion. Class 6 is when there is root fracture but it does not involve the crown. So this is class 6. Class 7 is the tooth, it gets displaced without the fracture of the crown or the root. So in this class 7, the crown or the root is not getting fractured but only the tooth, it gets displayed. Class 8 is loss of crown. So all of your crown, it is lost. And class 9 is when there is trauma to the deciduous teeth. So now when you get a question, so you can get a question on this, like it is a very commonly asked MCQ also. So you can get a question like, you can, so they can show you a picture, and even this is asked in your like entrance exam. So they'll give you a picture of a deciduous teeth and they will show any of the fracture, like it will involve enamel or enamel dentine or pulp or anything. So they'll ask you in the option which class it is. So always you have to remember, let it be any type of fracture, but it is of the deciduous teeth, then it is class 9. So this is the classification which was given by Ellis and Davis, and this is just a mnemonic that I made to remember it well. That was the Eddie, Drake, Peter, North. So these are four people. So they are rude due to the loss of the dad. So Eddie is for enamel, that is class 1. Drake is for enamel and dentine. Pulp, Peter is for class 3, that is pulp. North is for non-vital. R, rude. A is for avulsion. Rude. R is for root fracture. Due to, it is displacement of, loss of. So now the class 8 is loss of. So this is loss of their dad. So that is 9, that is the deciduous teeth. So this is just a mnemonic that you can easily remember, this classification, that is the Ellis and Davis classification. Other classifications which were given, this was the WHO class. So this was the classification which was given by WHO. Now this classification, it is very confusing because this classification, it has this particular numbers that you have to remember, and this becomes very like confusing. And the another one, the modification of W classification, it was given by Anderson. So he classified it, he just modified this WHO classification, and he classified it as enamel fracture, the crown fracture without the pulp involvement, then with pulp involvement, then the crown root fracture, then luxation and avulsion. So now I'm going to explain on this basis only. So I'm going to first explain about the avulsion. And if you want to know, like if I should make a video on all of this, so what are the treatment plans for all this, then let me know in the comment section. Then I'll make a video on the other factors too. And if you want to know about this WHO classification, then even after that, you can let me know. Then I can like make a video on it too. Starting off with the avulsion. So avulsion is nothing but the ex-articulation or the total luxation. So your tooth, it gets completely out of the socket, and hence it is known as ex-articulation. So it is getting ex-articulated. So it is defined as, it is the complete and total displacement of the tooth from its socket. So it is complete and total displacement of the tooth. The incidence of this avulsion, it varies It is 0.5 to 3% in permanent teeth, and it is 7 to 13% in primary teeth. So the incidence of avulsion, it is more in primary teeth. The main etiological factor for avulsion is sport and fight injuries. So it is due to the sports and fight injury, and the most commonly affected tooth is the maxillary central incisor. And in this, the treatment of choice is re-implantation. So nothing, re-implantation is nothing but you're just putting the tooth into the socket back. So that is nothing but re-implantation. The treatment, it is directed at avoiding or minimizing the effect of two main complications. So now your tooth, it is completely avulsed. So it is completely out of your socket. So there are two main effects which can be like caused. There are two main complications that are caused. That is nothing but the attachment damage. So now your tooth, it is completely out of the socket. So now your attachment, that is the periodontal tissue, it can get damaged and there can be pulp. So there can be pulp infection. So the treatment, it should be directed at avoiding or minimizing these two effects. Now the classification of the avulsed teeth. So they are classified into the following, and the treatment, it is done accordingly. So the recommendation and the guidelines, it was given by the American Association of Endodontics in 2013. So they are classified depending upon the time between the replantation. How fast the replantation is done. So whether they are replanted immediately or whether there is extra oral dry time, which is less than 60 minutes. And the next is the extra oral dry time, which is more than 60 minutes. And depending upon the classification of apex, that is whether it has a closed apex or the open apex. Now, what is this closed and open apex? So open apex, you will find when the tooth, it is like erupted. Now, as you know, the sequence of the eruption. So, you know, now, for example, if your incisors, they erupt at the age of 6 to 7 years. So now, you know, the root completion of the root formation, it almost takes 2 to 3 years. So in that case, it becomes an open apex. So the root, it is not completely formed. And in that, the apex, it is not closed. So the classification is depending upon this, because now in closed apex, now you can easily do the root canal treatment. But in the open apex, you cannot do root canal treatment, because if you'll fill something in the canal and the apex, it is opened. So that material, it will flow back. It will not retain in that canal because that apex is not closed. And because of that, the treatment modalities, it changes in the open and the closed apex. So now what are the clinical management? So there are two factors. So there are two ways in which you're dividing this clinical management. So first is management outside the dental office and management inside the dental office. So the single most important factor in the success of replantation is the speed with which the tooth is reimplanted. Every effort, it should be made to reimplant the tooth within the first 15 to 20 minutes for better prognosis. If the tooth, it is like reimplanted within 15 to 20 minutes after the avulsion, then it will show better prognosis. The tooth had been reimplanted at the site of injury. So if the tooth, it is reimplanted at the site of injury by the patient or by their parents, so the following instructions, it should be given to the patient. So if that patient, he calls a dentist, so what are the instructions that the dentist should give are, so there he should say, the careful holding of the tooth by the crown. So the patient is asked to hold the tooth by the crown, because over the root there is presence of this PDL, and if he's holding the root, then that PDL, it get damaged. So you're asking them to carefully hold the tooth by the crown and then gently wash the tooth in the running water without brushing or cleaning it, and examine it to be a certain that the tooth is intact. So it is not fractured. So the tooth is not fractured. The tooth, it is completely intact. Then avoid touching or scraping the root surface, as it will damage the PDL. Then have the patient to rinse the mouth. Then replace the tooth in its socket using gentle steady finger pressure. Then you're asking the patient to replace it in the socket with gentle finger pressure. Now if the patient, he is cooperative and he is able, then ask the patient to gently close his mouth so that the force is exerted on that tooth and the tooth, it gets back into the socket properly. And then ask that patient to come to the dentist immediately after that. Now what are the things that you are going? So now the patient, he has done this implantation on himself. So now he's coming to the clinic. So there are these two factors. Now we have seen, so it is classified into two, closed and open apex. So now there are different modalities for this closed and apex, for this closed apex and the open apex. So now in this closed apex, so immediate treatment is, now leave the tooth in its place. So now it is replanted by that patient itself. So you are going to leave the tooth in its place. Then you're going to clean the affected area with water, saline, or 0.12% chlorhexidine. And if there are any gingival laceration, then you're going to suture it. Then you're going to verify the normal position of the tooth radiographically. And after that, you're going to give a flexible splint so that the tooth, it doesn't move during the healing process. So splinting is nothing but you are just applying that wire on that tooth and you are retaining that position properly. So you're going to apply a flexible splint for 1 to 2 weeks, and the measurement for the splints are 0.4 mm. So the wire thickness is 0.4 mm. Then in closed effects, now it is a closed effect. So now in that, an intracanal corticosteroid medication, it can be placed immediately or shortly after the reimplantation, and it is left for at least 2 weeks. So this is the treatment modality for the closed effects. If the tooth, it is reimplanted immediately outside the dentist, outside the dentist's office. Then the next one is the open apex. So you're going to do all the same 5 things for the open apex too. In this, now you're doing the radiographic imaging. So there are 2 radiographs that you will take. First is you're going to take 2 periapical radiographs from both the angulation, that is the mesial and the distal. And then you're going to take a CBCT to consider, to confirm the reposition of the tooth. So if the repositioning is done properly or not, and you're going to rule whether there's an alveolar bone fracture or not with the help of a CBCT. Then the endodontic treatment. The goal for reimplanting, developing and immature teeth in children is to allow for the possible revascularization. So now if it is immature, so it means it has that open apex. So you are doing this endodontic treatment just so that you are allowing it for revascularization. And if it is a very mature teeth, then in that case, you're not doing the root canal treatment unless there are signs of pulp necrosis. And if you're going to see, so you're going to diagnose it. And if the pulp necrosis is diagnosed, then revascularization or RCD. RCD, that is the apexification, because it is an open apex. So you need to do apexification in that case. It is recommended in the case of open apex. Now, what is this apexification? And there is one more term which is related to open apex, that is apexogenesis. So apexogenesis is nothing but the formation. So you're forming that apex, and apexification, you're putting some barrier over that apex so that whatever the material you're filling in that apex, it doesn't go beyond that apex. That is nothing but the apexification. Now I'm going to explain this apexification, apexogenesis, because these are like very important terms related to your endodontics, that is pediatric endodontics. Now, so that was the first thing, that if the tooth, it is reimplanted immediately by the patient or the parent. Now the next scenario is, now if the patient or the parent, he cannot replace the tooth in its socket, then care in transporting that tooth to the dentist is essential. Now if the patient is unable to do that, so it becomes very important how they are transporting that tooth to the dentist. So the tooth, it is carried in a moist vehicle to maintain the viability of the tone PDL. So the tooth is carried in a moist vehicle. The tooth, it should be wrapped. So it should not be wrapped. So the tooth, it should not be wrapped in a dry handkerchief or a paper tissue, because the PDL, it will become dehydrated. The vestibule of the mouth, that is saliva, it keeps the tooth moist, but it is not ideal because of the incompatibility, osmolality, pH, and the presence of bacteria. So now there are various choices of the storage media, like how you can take this tooth to the dentist. So there are just 6 ways. First and the best way is this Hank's balanced salt solution, which obviously the patient won't be getting this. So the next thing that the patient can be asked. So now if the patient, he calls you and he says that I cannot do this, then what are you going to tell that patient is, so you carry that tooth in any of this media which is available. So you can say you can carry that in your own saliva. So what you can do is the patient is asked to keep his tooth in the vestibule of the mouth or a container into which the patient spits. But now as we have seen, it is not that ideal because of the incompatible osmolality, pH, and the presence of bacteria, and hence the milk is considered best as it is readily available and it is compatible to the vitality of the PDL, and it is compatible for at least 3 hours. So the next, like, storage media are milk, coconut water, propolis, and Viaspan. So these are again not commonly used ones because patient, they cannot get all this. So the one which can they easily get is the milk. So you can ask the patient to get the tooth in the milk. Now the patient, he gets the tooth to your clinic. So what is the management in the dental office? So first, the information about where the tooth was recovered, the dry time, storage media, which type of storage media it was. Then the mode of transportation of the tooth, it is essential for the formation of the treatment choice. Then the preparation of the root. So first you're going to prepare that root. So a topical agent that may be promised is alendronate. So it is a third generation bisphosphate which exhibits the osteoclastic inhibitory activity. So what you're going to do, you're just going to apply this on the root. So you're just going to apply this on, so you're going to apply this alendronate on the root. So there are basically two products, that are the alendronate and the emdogaine, which may allow the regeneration of the PDL and it inhibits or it prevents the resorption. So this is the preparation of the root. Then is the preparation of the socket. Then you're going to lightly aspirate if any blood clot is present. If you see the alveolar bone, it is collapsed, then what you're going to do is the blunt instrument, it should be inserted carefully into the socket, and you have to take care you're not like destroying or you're injuring the socket, because you have to put that tooth back into that socket properly. So in an attempt to reposition the wall, so if the alveolar bone is collapsed, you're just going to insert a blunt instrument and you're going to attempt to reposition that wall. Then you're not going to curate that socket. Then after replantation, you're going to manually compress the facial and the lingual bony plates if they are separated widely. The next is the splinting. Now, as I said, splinting is nothing but it prevents the movement of the tooth during the healing, and that is in the place for minimal period, which results in the decreased incidence of the ankylosis. So in this, a semi-rigid fixation is used for 7 to 10 days. The management of the soft tissue is, if there are any lacerations which are present on the gingiva, then you're going to suture it. And in such cases, lip laceration is very common. So what you're going to do is the lip wound is clean and it is sutured. Now there is adjunct therapy which I use. So in that, systemic antibiotics are given at the time of reimplantation, and it is prior to the endodontic treatment, and it prevents the bacterial invasion of the necrotic pulp. After that is the follow-up. So follow-up, the replanted tooth, it should be monitored by frequent controls during the first year. So in that, the patient, he is asked to come once a week during the month 1st, 3rd, 6th and 12th, and then they are asked to come yearly. Now what are the favorable outcomes and the unfavorable outcomes? So favorable, well, it will be, now you have follow up the patient, so now you're going to see the outcome of this. So favorable will be, now in closed apex, so the tooth, it is asymptomatic because you have done the endodontic treatment. In that, you'll see there is normal mobility and there is normal percussion sound. And in radiographic evidence, there will be no resorption. And in open apex, again, the tooth is asymptomatic with normal mobility and there is normal percussion sound. And radiographic, now it is open apex, so the radiographic evidence of arrested or a continued root formation and the eruption is found. So this is a favorable outcome. Now unfavorable will be, in closed apex and open apex, the tooth, it is symptomatic with excessive mobility or there is no mobility at all. That means it has ankylosed, and there is high pitched percussion sound, and the radiographic evidence, it will show resorption. So these are the unfavorable outcomes when you're going to do the follow-up. So you're going to see the outcome of it, whether it is favorable or unfavorable. So now this is the flowchart that you need to write. Now for example, now we have seen, depending upon the reimplantation which was done immediately, so we have seen everything about it. Now the second is, now when the extraoral diet dry time, it is less than 60 minutes. So this is the second thing. So in that, what you're going to do is, first you're going to administer the local anesthesia, then you're going to irrigate the socket with saline. Then you're going to examine the socket for the possible fracture and repositioning. Then, as I said, like I have already explained in the last video, so that was a brief about it. And now I'm explaining like particularly all these two. Then in that, you're going to take the radiographs. If you see there is closed apex, then you're going to apply a flexible splint for 2 weeks. And after that, you're going to initiate the RCD within 7 to 10 days of reimplantation. And before the splint removal, this is very important. So before removing the splint and after 10 to 7 days, you're going to initiate the RCT. And optional can be, now in closed apex, then you can put this intracanal corticosteroid medicament. And after that, you're going to put this calcium hydroxide intracanal medicament for 4 weeks and it is followed by obturation. So this is all about the closed apex when the extraoral dry time, it is less than 60 minutes. Now in open apex, so first it is open apex, then what you're going to do is you're going to soak the root in doxycycline or minocycline. The concentration of it is 1 mg by 20 ml saline for 5 minutes. Now this is open apex. So because of that, you're going to soak it into doxycycline or minocycline. Then again, it is the same. You're going to apply a splint. But now in this, you're not going to initiate RCT. Now we have seen this. So if there are no signs of pulp necrosis, you're not going to initiate the RCT. But if there is pulp necrosis, then in that case, you're going to attempt revascularization or RCT or apexification. So this is all about open apex if the extraoral dry time is less than 60 minutes. Now, if the extraoral dry time is more than 60 minutes, then what you're going to do is, again, the same thing, local anesthesia, you're irrigating it, then you're taking the radiographs, and you're going to see for the fractures. Now, in the closed apex, so first you're going to remove the necrotic tissue from the root surface, and you're going to treat it with 2% sodium fluoride solution. Now, as the extraoral dry time, it is more than 60 minutes. So there are chances there will be like necrotic tissue which has been formed around your root. So you're going to remove that necrotic tissue from the root surface, and you're going to treat it with 2% sodium fluoride solution. Then you're going to initiate the RCT prior to the reimplantation or within 7 to 10 days of the reimplantation. Now in this, after that, before doing the splinting, now if the extraoral dry time is more than 60 minutes, so before applying the splint, you're going to initiate the RCT outside the patient's mouth. So you're going to initiate the RCT like extraorally. So this is the difference between the extraoral dry time, which is more than 60 minutes, and which is less than 60 minutes. If it is less, then first you're going to apply the splint and then you're going to initiate the RCT. But if it is more, then first you're going to initiate the RCT extraorally, and then you're going to apply the splint for 2 weeks, then calcium hydroxide, and then you're going to see what exactly the prognosis is. So if there is poor term prognosis, then in that case you'll see there is ankylosis and root resorption. So this is all about closed apex. Now in open apex, so again you're going to remove the necrotic surface, you're going to initiate the RCT, apply the splint, and again you're going to see the prognosis of it. So this is all about the closed and open apex for both. That is your extraoral dry time, which is more than 60 minutes, if the extraoral dry time is less than 60 minutes, and if the tooth it is reimplanted immediately after the avulsion. This is one more term which is related, that is the autotransplantation. So what is this autotransplantation? So it is the process of transplanting the tissue from one part of the body to the another in the same individual. So that is autotransplantation. So this tissue is also termed as autotransplant or autograft. Now you know this, what grafts are. So you have studied this in periodontology. So it has been successfully used in the management of the tooth loss, which is following the trauma. The indication of this is traumatized anterior tooth. So now it is a graft. So you're taking like a tissue from one side of or a one part of the body, and you're placing it on another part of the body. That is nothing but autotransplantation. The donor site is from where you're going to take that tooth, and recipient is where you're going to place that tooth. So if the first molar is missing, then the donor site can be, so the donor tooth, it can be third molar. If your upper central incisor is missing, then the lower second premolar can be the donor tooth. If it is upper lateral incisor, so it is lower first premolar. If it is upper incisor, any of the upper incisor, then it can be supernumerary or supplemental tooth. If it is upper lateral incisor, then you're taking lower incisor. If it is dependent on the root shape, you can take upper premolar. So this is all about autotransplantation. So this is all about avulsion and the classification of the traumatic injury and everything about it. And this is the complete set of the answer that you need to write if you get an LAQ on it, or if you get an SAQ on it. So you can write everything about this, and 100% you're going to score like very good marks in this. So this was it. Thank you so much.